This is This Week in Perspective with me, Adam Simbeya. The rate of accidents and deaths on our roads, as seen recently, is a very worrying situation. Police traffic sources say at least 9 people are dying on the road every day, and that a total of 1,286 people have died and 4,177 recorded accidents between January and May this year. Why this carnage on our roads? To discuss this very important topic today with me are Geoffrey Mtei, who is a committee member and senior member of TABOA, Tanzania Bus Owners Association. Henry Bantu, I always call him a transport and road safety specialist. Senior Assistant Commissioner of Police, who is also the Director of Road Transport Regulations with SUMATRA. That's the surface and urban whatever. All right, SUMATRA is very well known.
Yes.
Last but not least, TK Mwambipile. She's the Executive Director of the Tanzania Women Lawyers Association. This association is carrying out a project which is very important, trying to bring the stakeholders together and discuss issues of policy on road safety. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
There's no apology today because everybody is here. Of course, one would have said, where is the traffic police representative? But since Senior Assistant Commissioner of Police, who was in charge, he was deputy actually on traffic issues, is here with us today. So let's do justice to this topic. As I said, it's very serious. We'll start with you, specialist on road safety. What has gone wrong with our road safety to cause the carnage on our roads we are currently witnessing? What has gone wrong, really? So many people are dying on our roads.
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. So much has gone wrong on road safety issues in this country. And I can be persuaded to say that even our road safety consciousness level is very, very low. And also, the coordinating machinery on road safety in this country is also very low. This is to say, the National Road Safety Management System leaves a lot to be desired, and there is so much that has got to be done. For example, talking about road safety issues, we are talking about an open system where you have got an input, you have got the process, and you have got the output. Now, when it comes to input, you have got the five, what we call the five E's. You have got engineers at work, you have got educators at work, you have got enforcers at work, you have got encouragement, an area of encouragement where you have got journalists, you have got politicians, and also you have got emergency preparedness. All of them working for road safety to improve road safety in a country. But unfortunately in Tanzania, you see, all these players in road safety issues are not very well coordinated. Each one is busy, yes, but busy on his or her own area. And the coordinating machinery is not existing. And in that case, you would be talking about lead agencies being not there, not being in place.
Like which agency, for example?
Well, there should be an organization which really coordinates all road safety activities in the country, which has got teeth, which is well-funded, and which can influence a change in road safety issues. And also, of course, you have got the lack of the national road safety culture in a country. Mm-hmm. We are missing that one too. Because whenever accidents occur, most of us are convinced that accidents happen. But experts really, and overseer should be for the understanding that road accidents are caused. They don't just happen. Mm-hmm. They don't just happen. But we have got Swahili sayings which keep on cheating us, like bahati, an accident happens, they say, "Oh, Mungu aliandika." It's God ordained. But accidents, in fact, we call them crashes now, they are caused. And if we can get away from that type of thinking that road crashes are not, do not happen, but they are caused, then that will be a good headway. You have got vehicle owners, for example. They normally take the road safety situation for granted. Like,
he,
for example,
you respond like Geoffrey will respond.
Here he is. Here he is.
From the
and I'm talking while he's here. For example, a driver can report to the effect that, well, maybe my tires are worn out. I have to change them. And normally, most of bus owners or vehicle owners will say, "Well, just go ahead. When you come back, we are going to change the tires." Mwombe Mungu tu. Now, that type of thinking, I think, is wrong. And when we say accidents happen, they are God-ordained, we are making a very serious mistake. So I think once we get away from such misconceptions,
yes,
then I think we are going to find ourselves making headways. Okay. Now I talked about the five E's.
Yes.
Unfortunately, in this country, the most active group of the five E's, of the players, seems to be the police.
The traffic police.
So much so that even our people think that road safety is a police matter. Mm-hmm. But road safety is not a police matter. Road safety is for us all.
Okay.
Each one of us has got to play a role to make sure that our roads are safe and that we don't lose a lot of life, and also we don't subject the nation to incur a lot of unnecessary expenses through, say, hospitals where we've got to take care of injured, and also people who die on the roads.
Maybe the burden on the families, I suppose.
Exactly.
Their relatives, maybe breadwinners.
Exactly. It is so painful when you see families losing their dear ones through road accidents. And you know, the death on the road are actually very painful because the involved don't leave anything in terms of will to the family. Mm. They just go suddenly. They travel thinking that they are going to come back, but then a hitch happens on the road. Some irresponsible road users, maybe even drivers, can subject this vehicle to get in a crash and people die.
Yeah.
But we are going to speak further as we go on with this discussion.
Okay. Let me turn to my left now for the older lady. Where did we go wrong? You've heard the road safety transport specialist saying there are so many, the EEs described them. What's your take on this?
Well, I think Mr. Bantu has said about the coordination, but then talking about the law, the law itself has got a lot of weaknesses, and that's why when you look at it, you'll see that at times even the law enforcers, they find it difficult to implement.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, that's when we are seeing, I think we're going to discuss on the causes of why there's a lot of accident happening.
Yes.
But then most of the accident, when they happen, the major cause is the attitude of the individual. So I think it's about time, he said, Mr. Bantu, that each one of us has got to do something about this. Otherwise, if we leave it to the traffic, or if we leave it to the government, or if we blame the law, as I said before, we are not going to we are not helping.
Mm.
Rather, each one of us has got a responsibility to do. Either you own a car, or you are using it, you know, like...
Even pedestrian.
Yes, even the pedestrian. Mm. Each one of us has got to do the part. to adhere to the principles and the guidelines and the laws that are there, much as they have some sort of weaknesses. But there are those which are good, that if you are supposed, if you are going to use a motor vehicle, make sure that you look at it, mm-hmm. you see it, it's safe to drive,
mm-hmm.
and when you are driving it, make sure you follow the whatever is there mm-hmm. in the where you are going.
If you go to drive a car on the, put the car on the road, as your writer says, you have to make sure it is licensed to be on the road.
Yes.
It's insured.
True.
It's mechanically all right, is
yes,
it?
Yes.
All right.
And even yourself, you must know how to drive.
Yes.
Because now we are noticing some of the drivers, they don't have the license, and even they didn't undergo the training. They just got it, you know, through Magumashi. And just go somewhere. Yeah, and I'm sure even some of us, we know some of our relatives or friends who have license, they got behind the back. So I think it's about time each one of us should make sure, and especially those, the law enforcers,
mm-hmm.
to make sure that they, before anybody goes to, you know, before anybody is given that license to drive, they have to test them.
Properly.
And
effectively.
Mm-hmm. And effectively.
Oh, all right. Now, before I come to you, the regulator, Sumatra, that's the Senior Assistant Commissioner of Police, let me ask Geoffrey Mtei.
Yeah.
You represent Tanzania Bus Owners Association.
Yeah, exactly.
And you are one of the owners, of course. You own the buses around.
Yeah.
Where have we gone wrong? These buses are killing many of our people. 30, 40 in one simple accident.
And more than that.
Why? What is wrong here?
Yeah, thanks. But as we are the road users and transporters, we have got several challenges on running these important activities.
Yes.
But the mostly and very important challenges which we are supposed to consider,
yes,
on how to reduce this serious problem, as I always call it, a serious problem.
Yes,
we have to check for. We have to look for drivers, for those careless driving.
Mm-hmm.
Those careless drivers.
Or reckless drivers.
Yeah. We have to check for them, and there are several challenges. How can I say, maybe a lot of challenges which lead to the road accidents. For instance, we have some of them, road sign, lack of road signs. For instance, we go to...
That's the highway code.
Yeah, yeah, highway. Mm-hmm. We have many traffic checkpoints which may lead to time consuming,
okay,
and thereafter it can cause overspeeding.
Okay.
Because a driver can look back that he had been already lost a lot of time,
yes,
to those checkpoints. So how can I go with time?
Mm.
Maybe he can over speed.
Okay.
That is some of them. But if I go back to the issue raised by my friend here, if I'm not mistaken, he said that maybe a driver can report to the owner.
Mm-hmm.
This
bus, for example, the bus is there.
Mechanical problem. And the owner can say that maybe you can go there
to once and then come back.
You can check for it. But this is not a logic. Before leaving to the any starting point of the bus,
yes,
or any bus stand, there are several stakeholders or important regulatory authorities. For instance, there is a SMATRA, there is a police, and everyone could have his own face to play.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, before bus to leave the bus stand, there must be a vehicle
inspection
officers,
mm-hmm.
who are supposed to take care and on checking that bus it is possible to transport a passenger from point A to B. And not only from the starting point, even there are some checkpoints which is responsible on checking this issue. If we found that that bus had got a mechanical problem, I think the issue is the enforcement of law.
All right. But you said it, Geoffrey, that some of these drivers are not really, maybe they are not competent.
Yeah.
But you bus owners, you hire these drivers. How do you hire them? You just go up into the street and say, hey, who wants to be a bus driver? You pick them, or you go through a process?
Yeah, drivers are the product of government.
Why?
They go to any IT. We are bus owners, we don't have an institute, I think so. We don't have a college where we can train these drivers.
Okay.
But we pick them from...
From
those who have a license issued by government, so that it is difficult to understand if this one is have got a fake driving license or whatever the case.
But don't you test them to see if they are aware, they know the highway code?
Yeah, we test them, and we having a good proper way on how to test them.
How do you address the question of drunk? And reckless drivers on your buses.
Yeah. On how to observe that this a driver is get a drink or not. Before leaving the bus stand,
yes,
there is the mechanical inspection officers or police vehicles officers. They are very careful on how to test those people, and they having special
equipment
on testing. Okay.
I turn to you now, Senior Assistant Commissioner of Police. But you are the regulator from Sumatra. You regulate road transport.
Yes.
It's the same question, actually.
Yes.
What has gone wrong? Sumatra has been there, and particularly the section on road transport, or we call it surface transport. I mean,
surface means transport regulatory authority.
Yes. But people are dying. Seriously, honestly.
Yes, indeed, people are dying. But Mr. Simbei, if we want to look at this problem seriously, we should look at it holistically. Okay? See it as a social problem. And we are living in a society where our morality has grossly declined. We are in a society where people not want to follow the laws. Laws are there, they know that the laws are there, but still people go ahead to
circumvent the laws, to beat the laws.
Yes, the laws. And when we look at it from the public service perspective, is where you find an ethical practices. For example, Madam, you have some point about how drivers are being licensed and like that. You see, it is all about the moral decline of our society. You know that you need to license a competent driver, but still go ahead, you license an incompetent driver.
Right, maybe it's through bribe. So bribery is involved?
Yeah,
you think so?
That's a service. That's a moral decline in society.
Yes, yes.
It's a gross moral decline in society.
Yes.
You see? And that is not only in the transport sector. Even in, for example, the medical hospitals.
Yes.
You see? The doctor sometimes may refuse to administer medicine to a patient, simply because he hasn't maybe offered a bribe. You can see people can simply die just for such a simple reason.
Yes.
You see, so the human life in society is given a very low value.
Mm-hmm.
You see, human life is given a very low value. That's why we can see people, the drivers over speeding. They know the consequences of over speeding.
Mm-hmm.
They know that they're carrying passengers from 50 to 60% in their vehicles, but still, one goes ahead, or speed, and at the end of the day, the vehicle overturns, you end up losing lives, and causes a lot of injuries to the passengers.
And so, these days, Commissioner Kaatano,
yes,
the modern communication system, the smartphones or telephones, mobile phones, you know, some of these drivers guns talking on the phone as they drive, and maybe at high speed. Is that one of those things?
Yes, it happens. And, very fortunately, it is provided in our regulations. Our regulation prohibits a public service driver to drive while on the phone. And we have been trying to sensitize the passengers that once they see a driver may picking the phone while driving, they should report either to the police or to Sumatra.
Mm.
And unfortunately, we're getting a very low response from passengers. But at least we are trying much to sensitize them because we are the regulators, police as the enforcers, they're not all in the buses
mm-hmm.
see what the way the driver is behaving. So we do rely on passengers. That's why we are telling you on a daily basis, almost, can say.
And it's the same passengers, so I hear,
yes,
that we even tell the driver, why are you going so slow? Go fast, we want to get to Mbeya on time.
Yes.
They're trying to encourage the driver to speed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Isn't that so, Henry?
Yeah, that's the case. And that's why I said our level, the level of road safety consciousness with most of us is still very, very low. And I think there is a serious lack of road safety culture
mm-hmm.
in this country.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say, before you talk about road safety culture, you have to talk about safety in general. Mm-hmm. I tend to believe that we have got three basic areas which are giving us a lot of problems in this country. First, you have got the area of safety. Most of us know. Before you talk about road safety, you start with the safety first. How do you look at safety? How do you respect? How safety conscious are you? What risk assessment do you make before you do something? We have got in our homes, for example. How many of us, for example, here have got fire extinguishers in our homes? Do we ever stop to ask ourselves? And if you happen to have one, have you taught your wife or your husband
or your son or your daughter,
or whoever stays at home while you are at work how to operate the fire extinguisher? Or sometimes, how many times do you get a door open and the person who was at home is not there, has gone to the market? You come back, the door is just wide open.
Somebody has got in.
Well, if somebody gets in, of course, he steals very, very easily. But assuming nobody has come, and you ask this person, why did you leave the door open? This person will just say, no, I thought I was coming very, very soon.
I wasn't going to go a long way.
That is one. We have got so much to talk about safety and how weak we are in that area. And then you have got the area of health. That is also a problem in this country. So many people don't have even toilets here. In this country. I mean, it's appalling. All right, you have got the area of environment.
Mm-hmm.
The area of environment, we are taking things for granted. Well, come back to which is the focus and the
topic
area
today.
Where our attention rests this afternoon. I'm saying, my friend talked about drivers, and I can easily say that my experience in this country is that with vehicle owners, not only bus owners, vehicle owners,
mm.
we have a problem of driver recruitment, driver selection, and how to control these drivers. You find that most of us just get a cousin or an uncle or somebody to drive a vehicle because he's cheap.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't invested so much on the human resource that has got to handle our vehicle from Dar es Salaam to Mwanza, Dar es Salaam mm-hmm. to Moshi Arusha, Dar es Salaam to Mbeya.
Mm-hmm. Or to Songea.
This guy, where he's lucky he's being paid, he is paid anything around 200,000 or 300,000, and he's very lucky. But the type of vehicle that he's driving is so modern,
With billions?
Yes. Anything around 500,000 of shillings to obtain one of them. But this guy, poor fellow, is paid 300,000. No allowances, no nothing. So you find that that is driver control.
Yes.
The area of driver control. You find that a bus, a vehicle owner here, in the case of buses, he has got 5-6 vehicles, but he hasn't employed a transport expert to manage these five vehicles. And we have got so many who are being being trained at the National Institute of Transport, and no one wants to go there to ask for the assistance of the National Institute of Transport to provide a guy who is trained, who can handle his fleet, because he's going to be expensive.
Yes, yes.
Which means most of the vehicle owners, it's money by all means. And safety.
Regardless of safety.
Yes. Yeah. And so you find that these drivers, drink driving is very common. And passengers, even if they see him, they don't shout again, you know, shout on him. In fact, sometimes they can offer him a beer.
While he's driving?
Yes. Where they rest in the to bus. Take a lunch. That's take lunch.
Is that?
Yeah.
Yeah, at times you see that the driver has a bottle of water. You think it's
yes.
water.
But that's
inside
Nicoba.
There, there's konyagi.
Yes.
The Viloba, isn't it?
And yes. Viloba. Yeah. Passengers will know, and then they say, well, that makes him, you know, more...
exciting.
More active. Mm-hmm. Exciting. And then you have got the problem of fatigue. You find a driver driving a vehicle from here to Tunduma, all the way, alone. We don't ask, what if something happens with him?
Mm.
We don't stop to ask that. Or sometimes, for trips like Damwanza, you could have two drivers there, okay. But then this other driver is also in that vehicle. When the other one is tired, this one is also tired.
Both of them are tired.
Both of them are tired. Even passengers are tired. It's wrong planning. And then you have got the area of overspeeding. You get a road crash, or what we call an accident, when we can't manage time and distance.
Mm-hmm.
And our people here love overspeeding. And passengers will always encourage this driver to overspeed. And if he's more careful, more defensive on the road, you find that passengers will not like this type of driver.
Or the bus.
Yes, or that bus. So the bus owners, some of them, not you, we always encourage this driver to move faster. And he was, if he was supposed to arrive at 4,
yes,
and he arrives at 3, he gets a bonus. He's a good driver.
Yes.
He's more dependable. This is the type of driver you have that, but this one is the wrong driver. This is the driver who has gone even against Sumatra timetable.
Mm-hmm.
This is not the driver that we should encourage employing in our companies. Well, in our bus, in our fleet.
Mm.
You know, this area is giving me problems because we don't have transport companies in real sense in Tanzania.
Is that so?
Yes.
Like his company is not a real company?
No, we have got a company of bus owners. Yeah, because a transport company, even Sumatra, would have found it very, very easy to deal with them. But today, most of them are driving through winds.
And there's so many
but
bus
they have got
companies.
Regulations which have got to be followed, Sumatra.
Hmm.
But most of them, if you talk, I mean, if you, for example, you say, well, these accessories, A, X, Y, and Z, should be for road, I mean, to maintain safety on the road.
Yes.
Most of them will find those accessories very expensive. But we don't compare, or they don't compare, the loss that they are bound to get in the event of an accident and buying these accessories to help the drivers in the event of a...
To ask me, I think each one of us, the different stakeholders, are supposed to play their part.
Mm-hmm.
The drivers have got to play their part because mm-hmm. they're supposed to be careful while driving.
Yes.
But then we have an institution like Sumatra.
Mm-hmm.
They've put in place their own system
mm-hmm.
where each one of us is supposed to follow.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, even the traffic are also, they are also supposed to play their part
mm-hmm.
because there's no way this driver who is supposed to arrive from Mbeya to Dar es Salaam and they are supposed to arrive in Dar es Salaam, like, let's say, at 6,
mm.
yes, and then they arrive
at 5.
Mm. Yeah.
Then something is wrong somewhere.
Yes.
Now, it's not about the driver. Okay, the driver, he's doing wrong. But then, how was he able to pass the Sumatra, even to pass the traffic, to arrive in Dar es Salaam at that particular time?
1 hour ahead of
schedule. 1 hour ahead of schedule. Then something must be wrong somewhere. So each one of us, different stakeholders, we have got to play our part.
Yeah, and that's why I said, madam, that the various players who should be key in maintaining safety on the roads are not well coordinated.
True.
I said, you have got engineers. They design the road. They maintain it. You have got educators who have got to educate these people how to use that road safely.
Mm.
And then you have got law enforcers who have got to come up and say, hey, you driver, you are doing the wrong way. You are told to do this, and that. And this road looks this way.
Mm.
You are supposed to use it in this manner and penalize that one or chastise this driver.
Mm.
And then you have got the encouragement part. I said even journalists, news, the media,
mm-hmm.
most of them, even the way they report accidents, it's in a sensational manner. When people die, that's when they make headlines.
Yes.
But they don't go further telling people exactly what should have been done.
To avoid that
accident. To avoid that accident. Or, for example, you have got buildings which are very close to the road.
Yes.
When engineers say turn road
15 meters
yes,
road reserve.
They want these buildings to be demolished.
Mm.
Then the journalists will just say bomoa bomoa yaja, say ubungo or something. They don't tell you why those buildings were wrongly built there closest to the road. You have got politicians. They are also part of the encouragement party. These are not concerned with road crashes. They are not concerned because they also take it for granted that road accidents just happen.
Mm.
Because they are also part of the society.
Yeah.
They are our brothers and sisters.
And they are the owners of those.
So, I think that's why I said, well, there's so much, you see, that we have got to do in this country to improve the road safety situation. We shouldn't only blame one group of players, road safety players.
Mm.
And in this country, more markedly, we are talking about police. They are single-handedly
blamed.
Active on the road, and they are the most blamed on road safety issues. So I say, again, we are going to speak further on the establishment of the road safety culture in this country, where everybody has got to play his part in order to improve the situation. We shouldn't just, take road crashes for granted.
Mm.
Something has got to be done.
Okay. Yes, Katan.
I think Mr. Banta said it rightly, but I'd like to go back to our road transporters.
Mm-hmm.
He said that they don't look much on the vehicles because they're sure that police will check them before they leave the starting point. Yes. But also they don't bother to test the drivers because police have got devices to test them. See, that's quite wrong thinking of all of us. See, we are the, as regulators or enforcers, what we want to do is to just to verify.
Mm-hmm.
But it's responsibility of the owner of the vehicle to make sure that his vehicle is not worthy before starting the journey. It's the responsibility of the vehicle owners to make sure that his drivers are in good condition, are sober, are not drunk before starting the journey. So when you wait for the government or for the police, for Sumatra, to manage your business, to manage your fleet, that's a wrong thinking.
Yes.
That's where we are failing.
Mm.
See, that's what Mr. Bantu is saying. We don't have transport companies here. Maybe we have bus companies.
Yes.
But of course, not bus companies. We have got business names. Companies.
Yes.
And as we're talking now, we're reviewing our regulations, and I want to do that requirement of having a restructured company, a restructured transport company. You don't want to be termed as a transporter. You don't want to be given a license, maybe of traveling for a certain distance of kilometers. You see, if you want to operate as a sole proprietor, you can get if you travel. And the distance of maybe 100 kilometers. Beyond that, it should be a transport company.
Mm.
So that's what we're trying now to introduce. Mm. And that is what a very big advantage. And that way you can instill the self regulation with the companies.
Mm.
But it will be easier for us as law enforcers or regulators to manage those stakeholders, like it is now.
All right.
This is very hard to manage.
Yes, Geoffrey was trying to counteract by saying no. you have companies now, Geoffrey.
Yeah.
I mean, Bantu said they are not transport companies. Again, restated
companies of
vehicle owners.
Maybe senior assistant commissioner report. According to my experience, I hope and I know that we have companies. Let me clear the issue raised by maybe my friend didn't understand me well. I said that before. We try to check these mechanical issues as well as driver checkings according to our level. Maybe we can misbehaving somewhere, but there are some mistakes which may occur and can be observed by
police.
Vehicle inspection officers. I already clear about that.
Mm.
Yeah, maybe you didn't understand.
No, I understood. You just give you an example.
Yeah.
Last week we banned one company.
Mm.
It's not that company caused an accident. What you did, we made a follow-up from 1st June to the end of to the end of June.
Mm.
You see, the way the company was operating, we were working with the police, inspecting the vehicles every time before they depart. The frequency of mechanical defects was indicated. Yeah. The police detected.
Yes.
Were over 10 times, you see, in a month, you see.
Mm-hmm.
And still we are receiving passengers' complaints that they're being delayed instead of leaving at 6, they're leaving at 9 because they have to fix the vehicle first before the departs. So through those records,
yes.
So, you're not.
That's why you banned almost 15 buses.
Yes, not the entire company.
Oh, the entire company.
Yes, because they're about 30 buses. Buses.
Mm.
You see, so what we're now doing, we are now to check the internal mechanisms. The other companies is operating. If they are what transport experts, things like that. But that is a long term company. A so-called campaign, I can say.
Anyway, he's trying to defend it. Mama, I know you want
I have something
to add. Oh, you have to add there, yes.
Yeah, yeah. But my friend over there, I'm not mean that all transporters, they are clear on this. That's why vehicle inspection are there, so that to check for those who are not maintaining well their vehicles.
Mm.
Yeah. There are some issues also raised by one of our colleagues. Said that maybe we are employing our relatives, we are paying low salaries, sometimes we are not paying. I think if I got my uncle who qualified to drive my bus, why am I not employing him?
Yes, and employ somebody else.
We are employing according to their driving license and their certificates who got from NIT. So we have to make clear on that.
You don't issue certificates. It's NIT which issues certificates.
Yeah, we are.
But you're also aware that they are fake certificates these days.
That is.
In every corner.
But sometimes they had been checked along the way.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. Mm. Mama, yes, you want to come in before I ask you another question?
Well, I just wanted to state that the issue of high accident rate is not something that's only for Tanzania. It's a global thing. Now, for example, United Nations describe road traffic accident as a leading cause of death,
mm-hmm.
and among young people, the age between 5 years to 29. Now, that's the most active age. And someone can wonder why now, as Taula, we are talking about this issue of road safety.
Mm.
Because now, you see, we are seeing a lot of young children dying, and we also see a lot of women becoming widows, and at the same time some of the women who are depending on their husband for their economy, you know, their daily life, now they are losing someone who is, you know, who was there to assist them. So, like, for example, the World Health Organization Director General Margaret Chan once described road crashes as public health and development crisis, and costing the world about 1.3 million lives each year. And when it comes to the economy part of it, $500 billion we are losing just because of road accident. So I think as a country, and all of these things are happening in the developing countries, and Tanzania being one. Eh?
Yes.
And because of that, I think, as we've been discussing from the beginning,
yes.
we say this should be a national agenda. Many people, we are losing a lot of people, and we're also losing money.
Mm.
So each one of
it's
us...
It's an expensive
yeah, it's a very expensive
aspect,
thing.
Yes.
And even in case someone is injured, the cost that we are using, you know, to cure this particular person, it's too much in terms of that particular individual medicine, and in terms, now let's say if it's your husband who is now sick, you the woman, if in case you're married, you have to go back, you know, the level of concentration at work would be low.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, at times you may even end up losing your job.
Exactly.
So let us be careful, and each one of us should.
Yeah, so you're suggesting that we need to have a national road safety agenda.
Exactly. The
very quickly before Henry comes in.
Yeah.
How do you want to go about it?
First,
let her respond first. How do you want us to go about it?
How do you want to go about
having,
he said,
a national road safety agenda?
Yes. Now, we need both of us, the government and even the us CSOs, to work together.
The civil society organization.
Civil society organization, together with the government and even public sector, to come together, form some sort of a coalition, whereby we do a number of review the laws, which has got some sort of
weaknesses.
Again, to do awareness raising, massive.
Much more than the road safety campaign.
Yes. Beyond that, even rural, each one of us, we have to do it. Because we did it during the HIV/AIDS.
Mm, yes.
And each one of us is aware. Now, even if you go to the rural area, someone will talk about UKIMWI, AIDS. So I think it should be all of us to make sure we make noise on this matter. We are losing people.
Too many people. Yes, but you want to come?
Yeah, I wanted to say, Tika has just reminded us that the issue of road safety is being taken seriously, even at international level.
Yes.
If you can get a situation where even developed countries are sorry for what is happening in our countries, then it must be a serious matter indeed.
Yes.
I say they are also concerned because it is true that road crashes have got a lot to do with the poverty level of a nation. The poorer you are, the more accidents
you get. But there are so many people dying in Europe.
No, come on, take even the slum. How many people are knocked down in a month by cars, say in a place like Tandika, compare with those knocked down in Masaki or Oyster Bay?
Yes.
You know, there is a striking difference.
Yes.
Yeah, and that's why even in the meeting, sustainable development meeting conference last year in Brazil, these guys reviewed the Millennium Development Goals.
Yes.
They found that actually in the Millennium Development Goals, road safety issue was missing. So they added to encourage developing countries to get more serious on road safety issues.
Yeah.
And you have got the UN, the UN decade mm-hmm. of road safety action,
yes.
which is 2011-2020. Now that one has been extended to 2030 because of this addition in the sustainable development goals.
Yes.
It means even at international level, they really pit us that something has got to be done very, very fast to save our people on the roads. Now, what has got to be done here? One, like you said, Mr. Simbeye, that we need to give it a national agenda.
Make it a national agenda, yes.
Yeah, make it a national agenda. Like Tika added that, well, we have tried to do that with the HIV/AIDS. And I think it has been quite a success. At least people are talking about, you know, HIV/AIDS. They know what it is. And the same should happen too on road safety issues. And in that case, therefore, every one of us, including politicians, should...
Including Sumatra.
Exactly.
No, and these bus owners.
These are technocrats. These are business people. Now, unfortunately, the politicians, if they cannot be part of the game, then we won't make a success at all. Because these are the people who have got, the politicians are the people who have got the people closer to them.
Yes.
And if they go there, out there in the villages, with the gospel of road safety,
yes.
then chances are that our people will know that accidents are caused.
All right, okay. I'm being warned, time is running out. I only have 5 minutes to wind up. A few seconds, very few seconds now, Mwambipile or TK. What are your final thoughts on this issue? Very, very few minutes.
I will repeat it again. Each one of us has got to play their role, their part. Otherwise, if we don't play our part, then more deaths.
People will continue dying. Senior Commissioner, please.
Again,
a few seconds.
Again, I'd also say that should be a concern of each of us, everybody. Be it a politician, we technocrats, transporters,
the media,
parents at home.
Yes.
Everybody should be
pedestrians.
Active. Pedestrians should act responsibly while using the road.
All right, Henry.
Yeah, I should say that the age of reawakening on road safety issues has just arrived.
Okay.
And we should start thinking more seriously about the people we lose on the roads unnecessarily.
All right.
And that will also involve building a road safety culture.
All right. Very quickly, your thought as a bus owner.
Yeah, as my friend already said, that everyone should take care on that, regardless of road users, regulator, law enforcers.
Owners.
Yeah, even should take on that matter.
All right. Well, thank you very much, my panelists. I mean, it seems it's such a broader topic to cover it in 55 minutes. It's not very easy.
Yes.
There's a lot we could talk, and there are so many questions which still remain unanswered. But you tried your best to answer some of these questions, because the main concern, as your final thoughts, is that everybody should play his or her part. I mean, all Tanzanians should play a part. And you emphasize the question of making road safety a national agenda. Thank you very much for that. Viewers, you heard the views of my panelists here. The carnage on our roads, as witnessed recently, is a very serious issue, and indeed a matter of concern to all of us, as we heard from my panelists here, those road users, owners of public private vehicles, and pedestrians alike. Latest figures, according to Commander Mpinga, as reported in Mwananchi of 8th July, are alarming. 9 people are dying every day on the road, and that in 5 months, January to May this year, 1,286 people have died and 4,177 injured due to road accidents. There is definitely a need to make road safety a national policy agenda. Let us discuss this serious development to be able to identify the root causes and address them effectively as soon as we can. The police is doing its work effectively, but the police traffic alone cannot really address this issue effectively, as it were, but they need assistance of transport owners, the bus owners, and each one of us who has the ability to drive a car and to maintain our vehicles on the road. It should be seriously addressed with the new stiff traffic regulations. Mm. In the interim, Sumatra should continue to ban all buses, as he says, that are not fit to be on the road. And bus owners especially, who ignore the basic transport safety requirements, are taken to tax accordingly. Now, these are road users in general. That's all we have for you today. Until next Sunday at 21 hours, and on Thursday at 15 hours for the repeat program. On behalf of my panel, Senior Assistant Commissioner of Police, Kahatano, who is the Director of Road Transport Regulation at Sumatra, Ike Mwambipile, who is Executive Director of Tanzania Women Legal Lawyers Association, with a very interesting project on road safety, Geoffrey Mtei, the committee member of the Tanzania Bus Owners Association, and a fleet owner as well. Last but not least, Henry Bantu, who is a road safety and transport specialist. He knows these issues. He understands these issues. Thank you very much. But not least, my TBC Television Center crew. Thank you, viewers, and goodbye.